19.
Everyone will be standing for prayer.
Praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice.
Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
We do want to go to the Lord in prayer and open our service at this time. And let me just mention a couple of announcements. We hope that we'll be able to continue on our Wednesday night service. We don't have many, but we're hopeful that we can get more to come. And have you heard from Philip? Is he going to do Wednesday night?
I don't know.
You know, they stopped school for temporarily, and he was going to talk to the parents, you know, all about. So we'll go ahead with the adults upstairs, and go, then we'll sort of go from there and make that kind of decision. But remember, each Sunday morning at 11, and also let me mention, as you leave this morning, if you have a tithe or offering you want to give the church, the offering plate's on the back in the table as you go out. If you need a mask, there are masks that you can have free of charge. There are prayer sheets. There's hand sanitizer if you need that. We try to do everything we could to make it comfortable when you come. And listen, let me say this. Bonnie, it's good to have you. We know you had your bout, not with that, but other problems. But we're glad you're able to be back with us. We've missed you this morning. Bonnie's one of those who, every service, you can set the clock. You're faithful. And, you know, God honors faithfulness, you know. But right now, I want to go to the Lord in prayer. And when you pray, be sure to remember, if you would, Brother Danny's wife, Tracy. She got a good report that she does not presently, as they can determine, have cancer, but she has to take this medicine for 1 year, and if she still shows no signs, then they'll declare her cancer free. So still pray for Sandra, for Tracy Scott. Also, Wanda Wright's sister and your family in Florida, we want to keep them up in prayer. Remember Judy Dudley. Judy had to be taken to the emergency room Friday, but she's able to come back home. Be sure to remember to pray for her. She has a serious physical condition. Remember Martha Coleman, her two granddaughters. We've been praying for them for quite a time. Their names Christina and Rebecca. Sister Coleman came when she could, but her health gave way on her. But she writes us a little note and sends us a little tithing offering about every week, you know. They took a 10-pound tumor out of her granddaughter's abdomen, and it was malignant. So she's going through a tough time, but we know God's able, you know. Remember Sister Mary Proctor. Remember Tony Tummins. Sister Rita, we call him Little Tony. Remember Little Tony, you know. He needs our prayers. Larry and Judy Johnson, continue to pray for them. We miss them so much, you know. Remember Snooks and Sue. They have a situation through which they really need God's help, you know. Also, if you would, remember Linda Bond. You know, she hardly ever misses. She'd been sick and been to the doctor. This morning, remember Tony and Carol Lee. Be sure to pray for them when you pray, you know. And we need one another's prayers. I need your prayers, and you need my prayers, and we all need to pray one for another. Would there be any other requests? Sister Bonnie.
I have a friend she's been my friend about 45 years, and she just found out she's got breast cancer.
We hate to hear that, yeah. Remember Sister Bonnie's request. Other requests. And Debbie, it's good to have you. We need to keep you on the prayer sheet. Debbie was in a bad wreck. I believe it totaled your vehicle, didn't it? But we're glad you're able to be here with us today, and I really mean that. God bless you. We appreciate you. Lord, I was thinking we go way back yonder. Back, I think you was a teenager when I made my first. We won't say how old she is now. We'll get in trouble. No weight, no age, and you don't get no trouble with the ladies, you see. Would there be another request?
Hello, Tommy. I'd like to remember my cousin, Bobby Hughes, his family. He's from Erin. He passed away yesterday.
Yeah, we've all lost a loved one. Sister Shirley, we know what you're saying. Any other request? Every heart and mind clear. Sister Wanda, would you lead us in prayer this morning?
Our dear Lord, we thank you for the privilege of being here this morning.
Yes.
Lord, we just thank you for everything you do for us. We praise you, Lord. We give you all the glory, even in hard times, Lord, because you said you're there all the time. And we thank you for everything you do in our lives. Our Father, be with these that have been mentioned, that have been on the sick list and the prayer list. They all have problems, Lord, that only you can really step in and do anything about. Father, we can only pray that, Lord, we do that. Father, just be with us this morning. Be with our speakers. Be with everyone that has a part. Lord, we need you so much. We need you every minute of the day. But Lord, give us the strength to get through the day. And help us on our way, Lord. And we ask that you bless us. Lord, just continue to hold us up. Because, Lord, we're weak people. And we're weak in everything. But we have you, Lord, and you are our strength. And everything in our life. I thank you, Father, for this day again. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Let me just welcome each one here today. We're glad to see you that are out today. We know all of us are aware of the situation that's within our nation, communities, and homes today. So we just got to be faithful in prayer and trust the good Lord. And one day here maybe won't be too long and it'll all be behind us. We'll just have to trust the Lord. You know, if you stop and think about it, we've got a great nation and it's gone through a lot. We can go back to the wars. We can go back to lots of things. We see bad fires out in California now, and I wonder sometimes, is the Lord trying to get our attention? You know, maybe this virus, is he trying to get our attention? You know, if that be true, if we're praying, staying close to him, either way, we'll be all right. So God bless each one of you today for coming and sharing with us. Let's see. Brother Jim, you got a song this morning?
Let me do this one first.
Do what now?
Let me do this song first.
Yeah, go ahead. Then we'll do ours. Hopefully.
Bless this is you, songs Lord. We're going to do this morning.
What page, brother?
You're not singing.
Huh?
You're not singing.
Is this the one you're going to do?
This one I'm going to do.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay.
What page?
65.
You heard that, didn't you? Go ahead.
This is a new song that I heard the other day. And I thought it was pretty, and a lot of you probably heard it, but it's the first time I had heard it. I hope that you get a blessing from this morning.
The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. Angel song, could we with ink be
can feel anywhere the skies of parchment made, where every star on earth's a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above, where leaves the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, through stretch from sky to sky. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song.
Amen. That'll work.
Mm-hmm. There you go. What page you got on?
288.
It wouldn't do that. Completely unrehearsed. Reed, I still think you need to come help us sing. Hey, we've heard you and Darius sing. Y'all are good singers. Years ago, I used to sing in a group when I was in college. We'd go out and travel to different places, and I'd preach and we'd sing. We called ourselves the Hardly Able Four. I think I know why. I was a clunker, so you listen to Jimmy, and I'll help him. How's that?
Shackled by a heavy burden, neath the load of guilt and shame, then the hand of Jesus touched me. This blessed Savior, since he cleansed and made me whole, I will never cease to praise him. I'll shout while eternity rolls. He touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me, and he made me whole. He touched me. Oh, he touched me. Bless my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me and he made me whole.
Now you sing one for me. Can you handle that?
I can sing one.
We'll sing another one. Do what? Yeah. And I'll follow back over here. Pop.
Okay.
Yeah. Make Jimmy sing another song here.
You know why? Because he's made like three.
Box one. 464.
Bless the Lord. Jim, give us a word of testimony while you get your song ready.
Well,
I'm fine.
I'd like to thank the Lord for all he's done for me.
Amen.
He's helped me so many times in my life. Page two. I'd like him for, you know, saving my soul. And just enjoyed being a Christian and enjoyed doing what's right and trying to do what's right. And, you know, it was February 13th I got saved, 2011.
Amen.
Got baptized in 2000, or February 20th. So it's been a while. I've enjoyed it, and I thank God for it.
Yes.
Thank Brother Tommy for giving the words and got me up there. And
yeah.
It's been a blessing.
Thou art, how great thou art.
get your blue books out, turn to page 2, and let's all sing that last verse, if you would please.
Amen.
When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art.
Thank you, Brother Jim. I remember the February when you got saved. I remember baptismal, and Jim had been saved about a week and come to me and said, I'd like to sing a song. I never could sing. I'd get up there and sing. Anytime anybody comes in and wants to sing, I'd get up there and sing. He'd been singing ever since, and his brother Bill and Snook sort of older sort of died down a little bit. They put him up there, and he does a good job, and we're just so pleased with the fact that he graciously volunteered to lead our singing, but they still do a good job when they fill in. Turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 15. I want to tell this message sort of like in a story, in a way of telling it. It's one of the great stories in the Bible. And let me just put a heading on it this way. This might sort of ring a bell to some folks. A country boy goes to town. Think about that. I know a little bit about that. A country boy goes to town. The Bible says in the gospel according to St. Luke, notice if you would in verse 11. And he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portions of good that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance and with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine or the hogs. And he would have fain or gladly have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy or no more longer worthy to be called thy son, and make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf or a young goat, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they begin to be merry. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for the great honor, the great privilege to call you our Heavenly Father. We're grateful for those that came this way. We realize there are many others through sickness, through the great, great concern of this virus, who have medical issues other than that, and all the others who are not able to be with us. We hold them up in prayer. But we pray this morning for those that are here today, the thought that we leave today would be beneficial and helpful to each and every one that's gathered in this place. My, you've been mighty good to us, Heavenly Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who gave the very best that heaven had to offer. Dear Father, you gave your Son, and we're grateful and appreciate. Now, as we break the bread of life, I pray the little thought that we desire to leave this morning would be beneficial and helpful to all of those who are gathered in this place. We know, Lord, that you've never failed us. You've never forsaken us. You've never left us on our way to fend for ourselves. You've always been there for us, and we're very grateful and very appreciative for that. In Jesus' name we pray, and amen. As we said, a country boy goes to town. You know, I don't know how much you know about Luke, but Luke was a doctor. He was a medical doctor. In fact, he traveled some of the missionary journeys. Paul had three missionary journeys. He traveled with Paul, not every one, but some of those missionary journeys, several of them, you know. Not only was he a medical doctor, but Luke was a Gentile. Not only that, he was a scientist, very brilliant man. Not only that, sometimes you may not know this, but Luke was an artist. And you know, as I begin to study this particular point here, I thought about Luke maybe putting this story on a canvas, like in a picture, because he was an artist, you know. But you know, this is a beautiful story. And I hope that we'll be able to share with you a few tidbits of information that'll be beneficial and helpful. If you'll notice verse 11, notice this young man's environment. That's important. You know, Bible says a certain man had two sons in verse 11. Now, here a good background is implied. This young man had a father. He had a home. He had a brother. He had a fortune, if you want to get technical. He was well off. In his home, he had joy. He had fellowship. He had love. He had a lot going for him. There's no question about that. He was the younger, and he had a brother that was older, of course, than he was. But notice something interesting. Notice his enticement in verse 12. The Bible says, notice if you would, the Bible says, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. Now, something importantly to stop and think and remember about this story is the older, in the book of Deuteronomy, it was taught to the Jewish people that the older of the two sons was entitled to a double portion of the father's estate. So here the younger son would have received about one third of what his father owned, and he had a fortune. He was well off, so we know the boy received a goodly bit of material substance. He was probably under a moral obligation to use his inheritance in a way pleasing to his father, but apparently this young boy ignores that, for example, you know. But we know that it originated in his own heart. We're told in the book of James, chapter 1 and verse 14, it says, every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. You know, if you're here this morning and you're not in relationship to the Lord, you've only got number one, self, to blame. You can't blame husband or wife or children or somebody else. You know, it's that old song, it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. And this young man had a problem. We don't know what caused him to do this. I remember hearing an old country preacher one time preaching years ago, back when I was in school, college. And he said this, he said, where this young man lived, most likely, it was not uncommon in those days, there were caravans that traveled. Sometimes there'd be maybe a half a dozen camels, and all the paraphernalia they took with them. And sometimes they would stop at a home like this to water the animals and maybe spend a night or two sometimes, which was not uncommon. And said it's possible that maybe this young son had heard something he had never been experienced to. He heard about the bright lights of city life way over yonder. And if these people seemed to be happy, maybe they were dancing and making music and having a good time. And here he was taking care of his daddy's flocks, vineyards, things of this nature. And maybe he got to thinking, as a young man might think, a country boy goes to town. He got to thinking, I'd like to try that. So he comes to his father and asks him for his inheritance would be granted unto him if his father did this, which he did. It would be a third would be his inheritance, for example. So his environment was real good, and he had a good thing going for him. But apparently, the old devil, working through someone, made him to be able to see the bright lights of the city, and he decided to take that journey. Notice his estrangement. In other words, here's what he done. He turns his back on his father, on his home. This is suggested to those who turn their backs on God in heaven. You know, I've been in ministry a long time. Many of you have been in church a long time. And you know what I'm saying? We've seen people come in, make a decision for the Lord, even follow up with beautiful believer's baptism, and somewhere something happens. All of a sudden, they're gone. They don't want to come back to church. They don't come back to church. And that's bad. This young man left a good home, left a fortune to go to the bright lights of the far city. Notice his entanglements. Look at verse 13, what the Bible says here. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them. Verse 13. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, took his journey into a far country. And notice, and there wasted his substance with riotous living, for example. You know, through his riotous living, he became entangled with harlots, outcasts, and evil and wicked people. In fact, verse 30 said, but as soon as this thy son was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him a fatted calf. So the young man went to the far country with a pocket full of money, plenty of substance. And when you go into a big city sometimes like that, there are people just waiting to take that from you. So we don't know all the details involved here, but this much we do know. It wasn't long before that which he took with him was gone. But think about that, he became entangled, for example, with some particular citizen who owned a big herd of hogs. Now, for a Jewish boy to go and feed the swine or the hogs was strictly forbidden. And yet, he had become desperate. And he got in such a bad situation with nothing, with no money, far away from home, through riotous living. The Bible tells us that he got entangled with some citizen of that far country and sent him into the fields to feed the swine. You know, always remember something. Satan is a good paymaster. You remember that. Here's a young man, and you can draw your own picture based on the authority of the Word of God, who had a wonderful, wonderful home. Apparently, his father was a very generous, kind, loving man, and he had a good home and servants at his disposal, and just about anything he needed. But all of a sudden, he wakes up one morning, he ain't got no money. He has nothing. He's wasted every bit, a third of what the Father had given him, and the Bible says, in riotous living, for example. And he makes friends with this particular individual who was a Gentile, because he had hogs and this was not permitted by the Jews. And he finds himself out in the field feeding, which was strictly would have been forbidden for him to be doing this, you know. I like this. In verse 17, notice this. And when he came to himself, he said, "How many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger?" Think about that. A country boy goes to town, and he sees things he's never seen. He does things he's never done before. He finds himself in deplorable condition, out feeding a whole bunch of them, you know. And you know, I've always said this is me in verse 17. The Bible says here, notice his enlightenment. And when he came to himself, you know what he saw himself as? He saw himself as a fool. No doubt about that. You know, the mistake of his first decision haunted him. You know, I can sort of see him, maybe sitting on a fence post or something, looking at all them swine, no money, hungry, and having to eat, which he would never have ate if he had been at home, you know, in deplorable condition. Notice again verse 17, and we came to himself. In other words, all of a sudden, watch this, old brother memory tapped him on the shoulder. And for a few moments, there was a vision, and something crossed his conscience, and he realized something. He could just look back home, you know, and he thought, he said, "Boy, how many hired servants of my father's house have bread enough to eat and spare? And here I am perishing with hunger. I don't have nothing to eat. I'm hungry," you know. In verse 18, notice what he says here in verse 18, you know. Notice his encouragement, what he said. "I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee." Boy, think about that. To start with, what really got him to thinking, the Bible tells us in verse 17, the first part, "How many hired servants of my father's had bread enough and to spare?" See, he was encouraged by the thought or the ability of his father to meet his need. He could go back and stop and think how it was when he set his feet under his father's table. He could remember the servants that waited on them. He could remember the music and the joy and the happiness that was in the home. And he could still probably remember as his father began to count out his inheritance. And now as there was nothing. Think about that. A country boy goes to town. And boy, did he have a rude awakening, you know. He said in verse 17, 18, and 19, notice. And when he came to himself, he said, "How many hired servants of my father have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger?" Notice verse 18. He said, "I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee." Oh boy, notice verse 19. "And am no more or no longer worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants." He was encouraged by the thought of his father's ability at this time to meet his need. He was encouraged by the thought, for example, of the possibility of recovery. You know how he thought that? He knew his father loved him. And he was encouraged, you know, about the possibility of his recovery through his father's love. And I might say this right here. Faith is in operation here, too. Faith comes into play here. You know, he had been feeding those swine, trying to eat some of the food they ate. As I said, old brother conscience tapped him on his heart, And for a few minutes, he could hear the music. He could see the servants. He could see that table of plenty. His chair was empty there. And he says here in a wonderful, wonderful statement, I will arise and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. I wonder how many have had to make that statement, maybe not just exactly like the prodigal here, but how many have made that particular statement, you know. In fact, what really encouraged him was he had the thought of the possibility of recovery primarily through the love of his father. You know, his father loved him. I would say his dad probably really was reluctant, but he loved his boy. And he gave him, you know, his inheritance, a third of his inheritance, you know. But notice his enjoyment. Notice, when he returned, he was received. You know, this is me, but I can just see that old prodigal son on his way home from the city. Here he's on the way home from the city. He's wore his shoes out, and he ain't got no shoes. What garments he has is ragged from working out there in the fields, feeding a herd of swine, in very deplorable condition, you know, outwardly. And all the way home, I guess he sort of skipped and sang and could just feel that the Father's love would come through for him. Notice here, if you would, when he, in verse 20, and he arose and came to his father, but when he was yet had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. I love that. You know, we're told here, as the boy sort of neared home down that road, he could see his father. His father was out there waiting, apparently. I don't know how many days he had done this. He was looking for his son, his young son, you know. And you know, I love the statement in verse 21 that this boy made. Now, this old country boy's been to the city, wasted his fortune or his inheritance, so forth, all, and done some evil and wicked things in which that one third should have been used to glorify his father, who in this case been his heavenly father. Notice what he says in verse 21. And the son said unto him, notice, first of all, his dad ran, grabbed him around the neck, and he kissed him, which was not uncommon in the Orient at that time. In verse 21, and the son said unto him, two things here. Number one, I have sinned against heaven. Think about that. And he said, number two, he said, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Now, if that ain't compassion, I don't know what it is. And you know, how many times, maybe we were not country boys that went to town like this fella, but nonetheless, how many times have we strayed away from the Lord, for example? And maybe we got out there and all of a sudden, Brother Memory taps us on the shoulder and on our heart and on our mind, and we realize something. When I was in that church, boy, folks was nice to me and good to me. In fact, I enjoyed the singing and the preaching, and I enjoy the fellowship with all those folks. Here I am out here now among a bunch of scoundrels. And what a bad life. Maybe he wakes up and he's got his hands on the bars. He's got in trouble, you know. Here's a boy here that didn't go that far, apparently. But what really brought it home was the memory that he had of the life in which that he was living in his father's home. Boy, I love his statement. I want to read it again, verse 21. I hope you got your Bible. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven, and in thy sight am no more worthy to be called thy son. Now stop, call time out for just a minute. I want to use a word here. Notice his enjoyment. If you can see him over yonder hungry, no money, feeding a herd of hogs over yonder in deplorable shape, and you can use a word like that, his enjoyment, you can do that because in verse 22, by what his father said. The father said, but the father said to his servants, notice, bring forth the best robe, put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf, and that's just a young goat, and kill it, and let us eat, drink, and be merry. Why? Well, we're told in verse 24, for this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they begin to be merry. Boy, think about that. A new beginning. Now stop, I hope you see this. What does his father do? He runs, gives him a kiss, give him the best robe, put a ring on his finger, shoes on his feet, and gave orders to the servants with music for the enjoyment. And now all of a sudden, he's sitting in a situation absolutely different from what he left. You know what we see here? We see the love of a father. You know, that's the love that our Heavenly Father had for you and had for me. We were dead spiritually. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians chapter 2 that we were dead, alienated, separated from God, not by distance, but by our sin. It's amazing. I've always been amazed. I was not saved till I was 29. I won't get into all my testimonies this morning, but I wish I could have gotten saved earlier. But you know, it's amazing. As I look back, I was working, had a car, was out of the military, gotten married, all of these things, and yet I was dead. I had a little trouble understanding that. But then I got thinking I was dead. One, I was dead spiritually. I was absolutely dead spiritually. I was lost. And it took the message. I've never forgotten the message. God's great love letter of mankind taken out of John 3:16 that an evangelist preached that traveled 600 miles for a revival. And for the first time in my life, I saw myself as God saw me. I was lost. Oh, I had a good car. I had a good home. I had a good job. Had a few dollars in my pocket. But I was lost. And you know, here's an opposite here. Here's a young man that took his money and spent it and threw it away. But he was lost. You know, good people can be lost. Good people. I had a fellow saved when I was up in West Virginia who owned a television cable business in the mountains. I mean, he was a very wealthy man. And me and one of the deacons began to visit him. And what his problem was, you know, he had so much of this world's good. You know what he said to me one day? He gets saved later. Okay. Said to me one day, said, now, preacher, do me a favor. Yeah, what do you need, Carl? Name was Carl Parson. I'll never forget him. He said, you've been down here four or five times talking to me about being saved and all. What can the Lord do for me? He said, I've got several hundred thousand dollars tied up over yonder in stocks and bonds. I've got a little interest in the local bank here. I forgot what he had coming in about every week, several thousand dollars. I'm set for life. That's what he told me. By the way, he was serious. That was his God, so to speak, you know. But you know, it's amazing how God has an unusual way of doing things sometimes. His son's name was Carl Jr. Now, he didn't take his inheritance and go to the far country like this fella. But I tell you what happened to him. He got hurt. He was a coal miner. And he got hurt in the coal mines. I'd like to kill him. They drug him out of there. And Carl called me. His daddy called me. And I took off to the hospital. And it was a miracle that he lived. But out of his boy's decision on a hospital bed, honestly, he only had one way to look, and that was up. He got saved right there in that hospital. His daddy got saved. It's amazing how his life changed. Both of them was baptized. We baptized in a creek in those days, back of the church. I baptized him and his son both when his son got over his accident in the coal mines and so forth and all. But then after he got saved, and Carl had a talent. He could play a guitar. He started playing the guitar and singing in church. And I can remember what he said to me. Sometimes memory would reminds me of certain things. What can the Lord do for me? You know, I've got a good business. I got stocks and bonds. I mean, he had all kinds of stuff. But he was missing one thing, the Lord. And see, this boy got over yonder in the far country, and all of a sudden, he realizes something. He was missing one thing. He was missing his Father. Here represents his Heavenly Father. He was out of fellowship, see? And it took the thoughts of how good it was before to help this boy to see the need to get back into the right relationship with the Lord. Look at the last part of verse 24. He has here what I call a new security. Notice the last part of verse 24. The Bible says, well, let's read the whole verse. And for this my son was dead. Think about that. Spiritually speaking, and he was. And is alive again. And was lost. And is found. And they begin to be merry. Six words here that's so important. He was lost and is found. And I think back through the years of how many people I've seen almost in that kind of a situation. Not natural, not just like that situation, but somewhat similar. I was in that situation. I had a good government job. I had a nice home, a good car. I didn't think you wanted. But I liked one thing, the Lord. And this boy left what he had. But when he got over yonder and lost everything, he woke up. What do we say nowadays, Jim? He woke up and smelled the coffee. He realized something's missing in my life. And it was his home. In our case, it would be our heavenly home. So if you're here this morning, stop. Call time out. And if you're not where you need to be with the Lord, listen, the Lord can make you alive in Christ Jesus. See? He can make you alive in Christ Jesus. If you'll just come and this boy makes an open confession here. He said, I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And I love what he said. I've sinned against heaven and in thy sight and no worthy to be called thy son. Listen to me this morning. God loves you this morning. I have no trouble. Nobody that I know of, church or nowhere, but I tell you, I could never love you like Jesus loved you. He died, paid the supreme price required that you through him might go to heaven when this life comes to a close. Just stop again, call time out, take a long, hard look in your life. If you're in the far country this morning and you need to come back to him, you come back to him this morning. I tell you what he'll do. He'll throw those arms around you. He'll bless you so good. You'll leave here with tears of joy, thanking the Lord for what he's done for you. Let's pray. As our pianist comes, song leader comes, we'll sing a couple of verses of an old invitational hymn, whatever our good brother decides. And I pray that whatever we share would bring glory and honor to your precious name. You've been mighty good to us. I just love this story, Lord. Brother Luke, or Dr. Luke, was a great medical doctor, great scientist. He was also a great artist. And when you read the gospel according to St. Luke, and you look at the various parables that he has in, he tells them like painting them on a canvas, like a picture. And somehow I can see this home, and I can see this path or road that led, and I can see that boy way on the coming, and I can see the Father with his arms outstretched on his way to meet that boy. What a joy. What a joy. What a joy of the night that I made peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. I've never been the same. I don't reckon I ever will be until I get to my eternal home. That beautiful, wonderful, and marvelous place we call heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. and amen. What page, my brother?
Page 309 in the blue book.
309 in the blue book. Would you be standing? 309 in the blue book. I love this invitational song here. Beautiful song. Without him. Without him I could do nothing. Think about it.
Without him I truly fail.
No doubt about that.
Without him I would be drifting like a ship without a sail.
Listen to these words.
Jesus, oh Jesus, do you know him today? Do not turn him away, oh Jesus, oh Jesus. Without him I lost, I will be.
We're going to sing the last verse. If you need prayer, never lose sight of something so important. God loves you this morning. The old preacher loves you this morning. We got a lot of good Christian folks in here this morning that love you. Think about it. Thank you for coming this morning. We'd invite you, and I know you will, be sure to pray for those who are sick, those who need prayer. And I know somehow God's going to bring this thing to a satisfactory conclusion. America's a great nation, and we've gone through a lot as a country, as a nation. We're going through a lot presently. But some way, somehow, if it's God's will, he'll bring everything to a satisfactory conclusion. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. And was dismissed from this place, certainly not from his presence. Brother Bill, lead us in prayer. Thank you.
Our Heavenly Father, as we come to the close of service,
yes, Lord.
Thankful hearts. We thank you, Lord, for your word today and what it means to us. We thank you, Lord, for the Bible itself. Lord, we know in many places, Lord, it's a,
yes,
it's a lost cause. Lord, we realize that our country is on the verge of falling one way or another. Lord, we believe that, I believe that all, whatever we do, we've got to do all we can do and pray and all, and keep our country free and keep it where the freedom of religion, the freedoms that we've enjoyed through our forefathers down through the years, Lord, are still relevant today. God, we thank you for that. We thank you, Lord, for each one that's come this way this morning. We thank you, Lord, for being with us. Lord, I pray this morning that you bless those that mentioned here today, those on the prayer list. Have your precious way. Be with us as we travel to our home, places of abode. Have your own way in our lives. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. If he's got any tithes, offering, collect them back here. Back in his.